So students, today I am going to explain some important point about the compounds of boron. And so we have seen yesterday about the borax. So today I am going to explain about the boric acid. Boric acid, you all must be aware about boric acid. H3BO3. Boric acid, H3BO3, we also called boric powder commonly. Now we'll see the preparation. So it is prepared by several methods, but some of the important methods which we can prepare in the laboratory, we can prepare in the laboratory, it is from the borax. Borax on acidification, borax, aqueous solution of borax. So Na2B4O7, it is borax. So borax on acidification, so for acidification we require water. So we need water, and this is the water. So here there is a aqueous solution, and on hydrolysis by acid, by acidification. So simply we can say that it can be prepared by acidification. So there is a solution of H3BO3 plus NaCl. So there is the formation of this is the boric acid. This is one method. This method can be used in the preparation of laboratory. We can because borax is available in market. It is also available in laboratory for different works. Now second method is from boron trichloride. Children, this BCl3 boron trichloride is reactive. It is hydrolyzed by water. So BCl3 boron trichloride, when it is hydrolyzed, when it is mixed with water, when it is mixed with water, there is formation of boric acid. Very simple reaction. Very simple reaction. It is converted into boric acid. So these are two important methods which we can use, and we can use in laboratory. BCl3 is not available in laboratory, but it is frequently. So simply by the acidification of the aqueous solution of what? Borax. Now children, you will see the properties. So you all must be children knowing this boric acid, it is used in carom boards as carom powder. You all must be knowing the carom powder, because it is very fine, slippery powder, very smooth, very delicately it is seen. So it is white colored. It is white colored, smooth, smooth, silky powder. Silky means it has slippery appearance. It is very smooth. You all must be using boric powder or simply carom powder. So carom powder is nothing but basically it is boric acid. So it is so slippery. It is, you all must be knowing, it is slippery than any talcum powder. Second point is, it is soluble in warm water. Warm water completely. It means it is little soluble in cold water. Cold water it is less soluble because of the presence of the bonds between the molecules. Now children, third point, which is you all must know, its aqueous solution is slightly acidic in nature. Its aqueous solution is slightly acidic in nature. Its aqueous solution is slightly acidic in nature. It forms when we dissolve in water, there is formation of very little amount of acid, and as a result of this, it is used in washing eyes during the eye fluid. So we'll see the usage of borax, which is of borax. So borax is one point, and this boric acid. So you'll see the usage. Number one, as carom powder, first as carom powder. The powder is used in carom board for a smooth appearance of the dyes of the carom. Second, as disinfectant. As disinfectant for eye during eye flu. You all must be knowing, whenever there is eye flu, the doctors, they give this boric acid and say, dilute in water, in lukewarm water, and wash eyes, because it is very mildly acidic in nature, and so the infection in the eyes due to virus during the eye flu, it makes the medium acidic, and as a result the viruses are removed and we are relieved from the eye flu. Now children, third is as chemical. It is used as chemical in lab. It is used as chemical in lab. In laboratory, it is used as chemical. Then, fourth, in making borosilicate, in making borosilicate glass, children. This is borosilicate glass. It is also called as Pyrex glass. And this borosilicate glass or Pyrex glass, children, it is resistant to heat, the change in the heat quickly. So it is heat resistant. Heat resistant glass. And in all the laboratories, the best quality of lab wares, they are made from the borosilicate glass, which is commonly called as Pyrex glass, and so it can resist the change in the temperature. You all must know that beakers, test tubes are made up of this glass, borosilicate glass. And because it can resist the slightly increase or decrease in temperature, so this is a very important point about the boric acid. Children, I am going to explain another compound of boron. It is diborane. It is B2H6. Its monomer is BS3. Monomer is BS3. Now this diborane is basically hydride, BS3. So it is hydride. It is hydride of boron, means formed by combination of boron and hydrogen. So it is hydride of boron. Now children, first I am going to explain its structure. It is very much significant. So it has bridged. It has bridged structure. There is the bridging in the following manner. So here we will see, and the two hydrogen are connected. In front of this there is other boron, and here we have this. So these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six atoms are in one plane. Now children, see the bond length. All the 1, 2, 3 and 4, 4 bond length are same. Now other is having this slightly different bond length, and we represent as HB. Here B, it stands for bridged hydrogen atom. Now children, you all must be knowing, it is electron deficient compound. It is electron deficient compound, and this dotted lines bonds are more. And so if you see like this, this 3 and this 3, they are in one plane. If I see like this, and so one HB is above, other HB is below the plane. If we see like this, so this hydrogen and this hydrogen, they are called as bridged hydrogen atoms. Now children, I am going to explain very important part, the preparation, how to prepare the diborane. So children, actually diborane, it is prepared by indirect method. You have to keep in mind, it is prepared by indirect method, it is not prepared by direct method. Because see, as you know, boron is very small in size, and so the energy required to combine boron and hydrogen is very high, and that amount of energy cannot be prepared. So this is true. Boron cannot be combined with hydrogen. Boron cannot be combined with hydrogen directly due to very high ionization enthalpy. You know, ionization enthalpy is very high because of the size of the boron. You know, boron is very high melting point. You know, the melting point is 2450 Kelvin. And so children, it is the melting point. So it means if you want to prepare the compound, it has to be at more temperature, and that temperature is not possible in any reaction. So in laboratory, thus it is prepared. It is prepared by indirect method. It is prepared by indirect methods only. So this is the reason. It is prepared by indirect methods only. And so indirect methods, we use some specific compounds. We use some specific compounds in this, and the specific compounds are basically the some substances which are capable of reducing the compounds of boron. So starting material is the compound of boron. The compound of boron is used, and so we use this.
So the first method is BF3.
BF3 is taken. BF3, boron trifluoride.
This is boron trifluoride and lithium aluminium hydride.
You all must knowing lithium aluminium hydride is it is reducing agent, and so as a result of this there is formation of
lithium aluminium hydride, and so there is formation of B2S6 plus lithium fluoride plus this is diboron,
this is lithium aluminium hydride and plus aluminium fluoride
AlF3.
And so children, as a result of this we are able to prepare.
This is one method. Now second is by this sodium boron fluoride.
This sodium boron fluoride, it on reaction with iodine,
and here we require some solvent. The children, solvent like ether,
because ether is neutral in nature. Ether is neutral in nature, so we take the ether, and so ether is stable also. Ethers are stable also, neutral in nature also.
So this sodium boron fluoride on again solvent is taken. It is ether, and as a result,
there is a formation of this diboron. Diboron is formed, and we are able to this.
So there is B2H6 plus NaI,
and as a result, we are able to get,
and of course, there will be formation of hydrogen.
So these are some of the important methods of this.
Now children, we'll see the properties of
diboron. We'll see the properties of diboron.
Properties of
diboron. So it is colorless. It is a colorless gas, children. It is a colorless gas.
So it is a colorless. Colorless gas.
It is colorless gas, and it is highly toxic in nature also. Highly poisonous.
It is highly poisonous. Highly poisonous in nature.
Gas, toxic, and it is highly poisonous in nature.
Now, third, as you know, toxic, poisonous.
So, it has very important point that whenever it comes in contact with air, it catches fire.
It catches fire spontaneously. It catches fire spontaneously when comes in contact with air. This is very important point.
Whenever it is exposed to atmospheric gases, it catches fire, and there is the liberation of very large amount of heat, children.
When we allow it to come in air, so there is formation of oxide of boron.
There is the formation of oxide of boron, and of course there is water is formed.
Water plus heat
very large amount of it is liberated, and so it is there. So these are some of the points, these are some of the properties of the boron, this diboron. Now it is hydrolyzed. Next point, it is hydrolyzed. It is hydrolyzed into boric acid. It is hydrolyzed into boric acid. Is that clear? It is hydrolyzed into boric acid, that when it is mixed or it is bubbled through water. So B2S6 plus H2O, it is gas, and so there is formation of boric acid and hydrogen gas is released. So this is the very important. Now children, next point. Actually diboron is, you know, gas, and so it reacts with different compounds. It reacts with different compounds, and one very important I am going to tell, that B2S6 and it reacts with ammonia. This is ammonia. It is ammonia liquid. Any, this is pure ammonia. Pure ammonia. And as a result, there is formation of very important compound B3N3H6. B3N3H6, and there is formation of hydrogen. This is boragene. This is boragene. Some persons may call boragene, and it is inorganic. Commonly, it is called as inorganic benzene. It is called as inorganic benzene, and has a structure similar to benzene. It has structure very close to benzene, and so there is the alternate placement. This N, this B, and this B, and here children N. So the 6 hydrogen, and the there is the alternate, there is the alternate single and double bond, and here there is 1H, 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 and 1H. So this is the inorganic benzene. This is the structure of inorganic benzene. Now children, coming to last, the usage. So children, it is very much important in the use. It is used as rocket fuel. I am referring to diboron. So diboron is used as a rocket fuel, because rocket fuel is very special type of fuel, and you know, when it is allowed to come in contact with air, it gives a large amount of it. So propulsion and the thrust required by the rocket is should be very high to overcome the this force of attraction by the earth. So as a result, so some special substances are used. You know, petrol, diesel, they cannot be used. They require a lot of other points, and so it is there. Now, second is, as research chemical, in the research chemical. Third is, in making boragene. Boragene is made from the this compound, and so it is there. Now next is, these are the 3 uses, and the 4th is, it is used in the many other hydrides in making hydrides making hydrides of other elements. Why it is used in making other elements? Because of its reactivity. Because of its reactivity. And so children, this is very much important part about the boron and its compounds like borax, boric acid and this diboron.